tonight is going to conclude our series on worship. And next week, we're going to start a new topic in this class that will take us through the spring. And that topic is going to be examining the evidence that is in science and nature and archaeology and other things that proves that the Christian religion is legitimate and real, and that the Bible really is from the Word of God, and that God really does exist, and Jesus really did live. And we're going to be looking at a lot of this, a lot of the evidence that's out there. We're going to be talking about evidence that the flood happened, evidence of, you know, that Pilate lived, that David lived, things of that nature. So, be thinking about that. We're going to start that next week.
I read that nobody had ever done that to the Quran. In fact, they precisely forbid it for the obvious reason that it isn't inspired.
I've heard that too. Was that in that book I gave you?
I don't think it was in that book.
I remember hearing about it though. But tonight what we're going to do is we're going to finish out our series of worship. And we've been going over, last few weeks, we've been going over the different things we do in the worship assemblies. We've talked about singing, we have talked about praying, and we've gone in real deep what the Bible says about the Lord's Supper. And last 2 weeks we've looked at giving, the giving of the New Testament. Last week we looked at the tithing of the Old Testament. And so tonight what we're going to do is examine the last thing that always happens in our worship assemblies, which is preaching. And we're going to see why that can and should be considered worship, and how all of us, the people who are listening, including the one person who is preaching, can make that into an act of worship. Come on in.
What's up, Jay?
Hey,
Tatiana.
How are
y'all?
Good.
Come on in.
Thank you.
So, talking about preaching tonight, let's go over to... That's right. That's right. You guys, I've always wanted to have an audience about this. That's right. So, I want to let you all know what I really think. So let's go over into 2 Timothy, starting out chapter 4. And now, Timothy, if you read 1 and 2 Timothy, if you read Acts, he was a young preacher. Paul is writing to Timothy in 1 and 2 Timothy. And so this is what God, by inspiring Paul, is telling a preacher about preaching. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. Paul says, Timothy, I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing in his kingdom, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. So a preacher is told, he's charged. The word charged, what does that mean? If I say, we don't usually say that in today's regular communications, but think about what it means. If someone says, I charge you to do this, what does that mean?
Instruction.
Yeah, instruct, a command. This is a command. So preachers are charged or commanded to, look at verse 2, preach what?
The word.
Preach the word. And that is very, very important, because, again, now in this class, what we're talking about worship, right? If I or anyone else gets up there in the middle of a worship service, and if I take the focus off of the Word of God, then that means I'm taking it off of God himself. And how is that worship of God, pretty much? You know, I like to make people laugh. You know, I just made a little self-deprecating joke a second ago. You know, I like that. And, you know, once in a while, for an illustrative purpose, when I'm up in the pulpit, I might make a, I might make something with the goal being let people laugh. You know, Devon Brock told me a while back, and he really shocked me too. I thought I was like, oh no, what have I done? Because, you know, he comes up with that, you know, this is how he looks. And he says, I really don't appreciate you using profanity in the pulpit. And I was like, what? And he said, yeah, you said the P word. I was like, I did? He was like, yeah, you said Pepsi. I just don't appreciate that. You know? And so the next Sunday, I purposefully said Pepsi from the pulpit. And I looked right at him. And, you know, so, I mean, I like to do little things like that. But if that's the emphasis, you know, which it can easily be, you know, to make the message just mostly humor, to get people to laugh, or to talk about the things that are secular, to turn it into a political message, or to turn it into, let me tell you about just my own feelings and my own experiences, and you make scripture a minority, or leave it out almost entirely or completely entirely, then that takes that, it moves what people are doing away from worship of God. And remember, worship is adoring God, revering God, wanting to serve God. It moves that away from that mindset, that atmosphere, and into something else. And so I can understand why Paul here says, preach the word, you know. And he tells the preacher to be ready in season and out of season. In season and out of season, what does that mean? Anyone have any idea?
At any time.
Favorable time.
Yeah. If something, when it's popular and when it's not, you know, be ready to do so. And then look at the three things he tells preachers to do when they're preaching the word: to reprove, rebuke, and exhort. Reprove and rebuke, they're kind of closely knit together. Reprove means to prove again, and usually that's in a kind of a correcting mindset. Rebuke, obviously, is self-explanatory. But look at that last one, exhort. What does it mean to exhort?
Encourage,
and I would say even encourage with zeal.
Motivate.
Yeah, encourage with the goal being not just, and this is included in it, but not just it's going to be okay, everything's going to be fine, but more along the lines of it's going to be okay, everything's fine. No, you can do this. Let's get out. Let's get out and let we can serve God. God is with us. You are not alone. We can do what God wants us to do, so let's all get out and do it together.
Well, there's a connotation of passion and energy.
Yes. Exactly.
And exhort.
And in the Greek, that's we get exhort from, that's exactly there. That's a major part of the definition, that you're wanting to motivate. And as a preacher, it's what I tend to do I have it on my calendar to do it every 2 or 3 months, and that is I take some time and I look back over the sermons that I preached the previous months, and I have these three words in my mind: reprove, rebuke, and exhort. And I look back over the outlines and everything, and I was like, okay, how much reproving have I done? How much rebuking have I done? How much exhorting have I done? And you know, the goal being is, as I look for the next month or so of preaching, have I done a little bit more reproving this than I have exhorting? Okay, then I need to. In other words, I'm trying to keep it balanced. You don't want to focus. If all I do week after week is give the reproving and rebuking, you know, we need to work on this and we haven't been doing this, and that's all you hear Sunday after Sunday, then what would your all's reaction be after a while when you're walking out of the worship service?
Like we've taken a beating.
Exactly. It's like, man, what this Christianity thing's pretty hard. I just can't do anything right, you know? But then there's the other extreme too. The other extreme is if you hear over and over again, and that's all you hear for a long time, is the encouragement and the exhortation with, hey, we can do this, and we're doing this right, and we're doing this right, and we're doing this good and everything, and you never do hear anything, but this is something from the scriptures that we need to work on. This is something that we might be falling short in and we need to give attention to. Then that brings the, well, you know, there's, we don't have the right attitude or the right perspective about sin that we need to have as well. So I appreciate that he includes all three in here. And as a preacher, one of the things that I try to do is have a balance of these types of sermons. Notice the last thing that he says here, with complete patience and teaching. Patience, why? Or some of your translations might say long suffering. Why is he told to preach the word with complete long suffering or patience?
We as humans tend to be kind of boneheaded. Mm-hmm. You know, pick up on things right away, or accept things that we should.
Yeah.
Well, I think he's also speaking to how you approach the sermon itself. You can reprove and rebuke people, but you can do it in a way that people can accept without feeling defensive.
The patience there plays a big part in that. It's when I was younger, starting out, you know, you give the type of reproving or rebuking type of sermons where we need to do this. And, you know, you get a lot of amens from that. But then 2 weeks go by, a month goes by, and just everyone, just from what I can observe, everyone just, there's no real change. And I could get really frustrated, and it would come out in my preaching, you know. And that was counterproductive. And so when you're looking, your point is well made. People generally, even the ones that in the church that they want to be like God wants them to be, and they want to grow. And so when they hear a message and it's like, oh, wow, you know what, I do need to change in that, and they completely agree with it, it generally still takes people, human beings, it's human nature, it takes people time to grow. It takes people time to change in a positive way. Habits are hard to break. And so what God's telling the preacher here is when you're preaching the word, you need to just go into it with a given of, you have to know that you're going to be patient. You need to know that this is going to take time. You need to accept that. And as you were bringing that down, this, when you accept that even while you're making the sermon, then it helps you prepare the sermon and prepare how you do it in such a way that, again, you're not beating people over the head with.
Well, I think you also have to look at it the same way that you look at reaching out to other people. Your job is to give the message. It's the other person's job to either accept or reject or make it part of their lives. Mm-hmm. And at some point, that's out of your hands. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, you can't take it personally if you've done everything you can do as a preacher or whoever's preaching. And it, you know, and people don't make that part of their lives if they need to. Mm-hmm. So it's not kind of the same thing when we speak to people outside the church and they don't accept what we're teaching them. You know, at some point, all we can do is teach them. We can't make them make that decision. And the same thing happens, you know, from your perspective with the congregation. You can't make them do what you feel like they should do. They have to do that themselves. Your job is to put it in front of them in a way that you feel like you need to, and they can accept it or not accept it.
Very true. And, you know, again, my first 5 years, 8 years, somewhere in there, that it took me a while to get that.
Well, I mean, and I'm sure because, I mean, it'd be very hard because anybody that takes pride in what they do, they take it personally. If they were giving them a message and they knew what they should be doing, I mean, if you have any kind of self-awareness, you're sitting there going, okay, what am I doing or not doing that I should be doing that we're not getting the change we get? And so there's a balance there. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you have to sometimes, everybody that's self-aware of anything that they do in life, you have to self-evaluate But by the same token, once you feel like, hey, look, I've done everything in this regard I can do, you just have to, you know, figure, you know, move on and figure out something else to do.
Yeah, and that's, and that, you know, with it, what I tend to do is, you know, people give me feedback as when preaching, and some of the feedback, one of the things that I've had to train myself to do is that when I'm receiving feedback, is this something that is what's being talked about? Is it something that actually is in my control? So if it is, then does it have merit? Be honest. And if it does have merit, then work accordingly. You know, and if it doesn't, and usually when it doesn't, it is something that actually is not in my control. It's in the other people's control. Then my dad always said, let it go off your back like water off a duck's back, you know. So, but again, that it took me a long time. It took me a long time to get that. Yes.
Real quick comment on the patience aspect of it. Mm-hmm. You talked to this before in 1 Corinthians 13. It defines the characteristics of what love is, and mm-hmm. patience was one of them.
The first one, I think. Yeah, you're exactly right.
If you're teaching, is it the beginning of that? Chapter 13, where Paul was saying, you know, if I give my body to be burned,
yes,
does no profit, but I don't have love. So I guess you could say your whole point of the patience is it comes from love, and without that love, the teaching is pointless.
Mm-hmm. And that brings up another point that for me, and I'm focusing on me first to just get that out of the way, because I want us to focus on everyone else as the listeners. But one thing that I have to constantly be reminding myself in the preparation and then on Sunday mornings when I'm out there is, how am I approaching this? You know, is this my, if the number one or even the sole mindset and perspective I have on what I do is, all right, this is my job, this is what I get the paycheck for, and so this is my on time, I'm on the clock, so, you know, things like that. I'm not really going to be truly doing it out of love, you know? And so while all that, the fact that it is my job and everything shouldn't be ignored, and that I don't ignore it, but at the same time, what I have to always be reminding myself when I'm preparing the sermons and then when I'm out there is, part of what I'm doing, the main thing out of what I'm doing, it must be out of love, and love as defined in that 1 Corinthians 13. I have to, what I'm saying has to be out of a motivation, out of love for everyone that's listening, because what I want is, more than anything else, is not to get the paycheck. It is for everyone who's listening to go to heaven, and this will help them. And again, part of that love requires that patience. That's a very good point. Let's go to 1 Timothy chapter 4. And here's something else that, yeah, 1 Timothy chapter 4.
I don't have a
4. Oh, you
don't?
Yeah, you're in 1 Timothy.
Okay, I'll leave that one. Yeah.
Okay. So 1 Timothy chapter 4, and looking at verse 13 and 15 and 16. Well, verse 11, too. It says, command and teach these things. That's part of it. Kind of like what he said in 2 Timothy 4. He says, to preach the word with patience and teaching. These things, when we preach the word, we are preaching commands and instruction from God. Preaching and teaching, you know, people talk about there being difference between the two. And there is on the surface, you know, but the core of it, they're basically the same. At the foundation of it, it is a big part of preaching is to teach and command. Look at verse 13. What I have to be doing as a preacher, again, is to devote myself. ESV says to devote myself to the public reading of Scripture, to exhortation, to teaching. Scripture must be read. Scripture must be taught. People must be exhorted, strongly encouraged, motivated with zeal and passion. People must be taught the word. Look at verse 15 and 16. The preacher is told what you're commanding, what you're teaching, verse 11. Verse 15 says, practice these things. Immerse yourself in them so that all may see your progress. You know, preachers have to grow too. They have to grow closer to God too, just like all the rest of us. And just as you would want God and you would want your brothers and sisters in Christ, as the weeks and months and years go by, that you would want your fellow Christians and the Lord to be able to see a change in you for the positive, that slowly but surely you are growing to be more of what Christ would want you to be. Well, the preacher's told that too here. And the way to do it is to the things that you preach, you yourself, preacher, must practice them. You must immerse yourself in them. And that's how you grow, and that's how your growth is evident. And then verse 16, keep a close watch on yourself and on the teaching. Persist in this, for by so doing you will save both yourself and your hearers. I'm not perfect, and I have struggles just like everyone else. And a lot of people will look at preachers, they'll look at elders, they'll look at deacons as kind of the assumption will be made that we're supermen, or we're super Christians, that we got it all together, that we're 100% got this Christianity thing down pat. And that's not the case. We all have growth that we need to do. We all have our strengths and we have our weaknesses. We have our flaws. But what God wants out of us is the same thing he wants out of all of you who also have your strengths and your flaws. And that is, just keep, it's kind of like the theme of the sermons on Sunday morning this year. Keep pressing forward. Progress. And the way you do it is, for me as the preacher and for you as the Christian, I have to practice what I preach as best I can. I have to immerse myself in the scriptures. I have to keep a close watch on me. I have to keep a close watch on teaching. And if I do it persistently, then notice that last part of verse 16. This is how I not only save myself, but I also save those who hear me. Now, I know that in the end, God is the one who saves, but as a preacher, I'm the instrument that God is using in this particular format here. So I wanted to start the class by just bringing that up, because I wanted to give you kind of a scriptural perspective of my perspective as a preacher, like what I do, what my goals are with the lessons and the Bible classes and the Bible studies. So before we move on to the next, anyone got any comments or thoughts?
That's one thing that's impressive about Christianity, because in societies and religions, sometimes the elders or whatever get a pass. In Christianity, nobody gets a pass. The prophets, preachers, elders all have to obey the exact same laws and admonitions. That's very impressive. And it speaks to the inspiration of
it. Yeah, exactly.
Absolutely. And the teachers are actually held more strictly in Christianity, it seems like. So they'd be judged more harshly.
Well, that's black letter law. You are held to a different standard than you teach.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So, any other thoughts?
I wanted to commend the preacher we have. I feel like you did a good job there and all of you.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. I do my best.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. Let's look at the benefits for you all of just the act of preaching in the worship assemblies. Okay, I want you to go to Matthew 13 and someone read verses 16 and 17. Matthew 13, verses 16 and 17.
Blessed are your eyes because they see, and your ears because they hear. I tell you the truth, many prophets and righteous people long to see what you see, but they did not see it. They long to hear what you hear, but they did not hear it.
One that whenever I read this passage, here's something that just, when it comes into my head, it just kind of makes me stop, and I'm almost filled with the feeling of wow. And that is, anytime I am reading anything out of the New Testament, anytime I'm hearing a lesson and what's being taught is out of the New Testament, then I am hearing something or reading something that Moses never heard, that Noah never heard, that Isaiah never heard, that Daniel never heard, or David or Solomon, the wisest man who lived, and he never heard this. And I am hearing it. And Jesus said they wanted to hear it. They longed to hear it. And they didn't, and you are. And, you know, we sometimes in the church, you might have heard this said before, like, if you could go back in time and go to any particular scene in the Bible, where would you go? And a lot of people say the cross or the birth of Jesus or the creation or, you know, things like that. But if we could go back in time and we could go and talk to the people of the Old Testament, this verse is saying, well, here's what I would like to see. I would like to see the Messiah. I would like to sit at his feet and hear his message from God. And when we're hearing the word of God, we are blessed because we are hearing something, especially when it's in the New Testament, that righteous people who lived before us in the Old Testament, they didn't get to hear it, and we do. So when we're in the worship assembly and it's the preaching's about to start, one thing that we can do to make our listening an act of worship is to say, I am about to receive a blessing. And the blessing has nothing to do with John Mitchell or whoever's up there. Whoever's up there, I don't care who it is. If they are opening up the scriptures and they are sharing with me the words of Jesus, the words of God, that's a blessing. I'm about to receive a blessing. Not from the preacher. I'm about to receive a blessing from God through the preacher and through what he's saying. So there's benefits that we can get out of this, and that's one of it. Any thoughts? Any questions? Here's something else. You remember what, and this is something that's quoted a lot, Romans 10, verse 17. So faith comes by
hearing
the word of God. That's right. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. Faith comes by hearing. When the word of God is being preached, then that is an opportunity for the faith that you have to be developed and grow stronger. And it's your faith that saves you. You know, by grace you are saved through faith, Ephesians 2, verse 8. And so when you are hearing a message from the Bible on Sundays or right here in this class or anytime you're reading or whenever, when you are hearing the proclamation of the Word of God, that is an opportunity for the faith that saves you to develop and grow stronger. And that just brings you even closer to salvation. So, talking about how we can make listening an act of worship, have this perspective. Not only is it a blessing, but it's also a way to bring you closer to heaven through helping your faith. Does that make sense? Now look at something else. Go to Colossians 1, verse 6. And someone read that for me. Colossians 1 through 1 verse 6.
Which is come to you just as in all the world, also and constantly bearing fruit, increasing even as it has been doing in you also since the day you heard of it and understood the grace of God and truth.
Now, if you look up at verse 5, what he's talking about there is the word of truth, the gospel. That's what verse 5 says. So the word of God, the word of truth, the gospel. Verse 6, it's come to you, he tells the church, indeed, in the whole world, it's bearing fruit and growing. So it's bearing the gospel, the word of truth, is bearing fruit and growing. Now notice what he says in verse 6. As it also does among you. In other words, you are bearing fruit and growing through the word of truth, the gospel. And you've been doing that, last part of verse 6, since the day you heard it and understood the grace of God in truth. See, one of the things when I started preaching, and I didn't, a lot of preachers, they go to preaching schools where they're formally taught. I never did do that. First few years of my preaching, my dad, who preached on the other side of town and had been preaching for decades at that point, he was my mentor. He was the one that taught me a lot of things about preaching. And I remember one of the things that he said to me, he said, preaching, John, is more than, when you preach the word, it's more than just the reading of Scripture. You do read Scripture. You do point out what the Scripture says. But he took me to this verse in Nehemiah, and I'd like to share it with you. Nehemiah chapter 8. Now, in Nehemiah chapter 8, you have Ezra the scribe and a bunch of other priests, and they stood up there in front of the nation of Israel, and they read the law of Moses out loud to them. So they were reading the Old Testament to the people of Israel. And if you look at chapter 8, verse 7 and 8, it says also Jeshua, and then all these other names that are hard to pronounce here. It says that they helped the people to understand the law while the people remained in their places. Verse 8, they read from the book, from the law of God clearly, and they gave the sense so that the people understood the reading. And what Dad told me when he pointed this out to me, he said, what you as a preacher, what you have to do is not just read the Scripture, you have to help people understand the Scripture. You have to give the sense, as they say, to help people understand it. It's kind of like, do you guys remember the Ethiopian eunuch in Acts 8? He's reading Isaiah 53 in that chariot, and Philip, the preacher, runs up to him, and the first thing Philip says to him is, do you understand what you're reading? And what did that Ethiopian say in return? Do you guys remember? How can I understand what someone teaches me? Or how can I understand what someone explains it to me? And my dad was basically saying, that's your job. That is your job. To not only preach the word by reading it, but preach the word by explaining it so that the people who are listening can understand it. And the reason why this is so important is, going back to Colossians 1 verse 6, is when they heard the word and they understood it, that's what caused them to bear fruit and grow. So look at preaching this way. When in the worship service, when the sermon's about to start, look at it this way. This is an opportunity for me to learn how to bear more fruit for God. This is an opportunity for me to learn how to grow, because what causes me to bear fruit and grow, according to Colossians, is when I hear and understand the gospel, the word of truth, which is being proclaimed. Does that make sense? So look at something else too. Hebrews chapter 2. And someone read the first three verses. Hebrews 2, the first three verses.
Hebrews
So we must listen very carefully to the truth we have heard, or we may drift away from it. For the message God delivered through angels has always stood firm, and every violation of the law and every act of disobedience was punished. So what makes us think we can escape if we ignore this great salvation that was first announced by the Lord Jesus himself and then delivered to us by those who heard him speak?
Okay, so notice what the writer of Hebrews is saying here. Verse 1. We must pay much closer attention to what we have heard so that we don't do what?
Drift away.
Drift away from it. So that we don't... Now, how many of you have heard the term apostasy? You ever heard that before?
Apostate.
Yeah, apostate or apostasy. What does that word mean?
Someone who's left the faith.
That's right. In fact, the word itself is just a transliteration of a Greek word, apostasia, which means literally to fall away. That, to drift away, to fall away. What keeps us from, if you look at verse 3, neglecting such a great salvation? What keeps us from verse 1 drifting away from our from salvation, falling away from it? Verse 1 says, pay much closer attention to what? Verse 2, to the message that proved to be reliable, to the word of God that's being preached. So again, Sunday comes, the sermon's about to start, the Bible class is about to start, or throughout the week you're reading the word of God. Have this mindset. What's about to happen, I need to pay very close attention, because this, if I pay close attention and I take it into my heart and I apply this to my life, this is what helps keep me on that straight and narrow path to heaven. This is what helps keep me from drifting away, from falling away. You know, look at the preaching and teaching of God's word as something that will help your salvation. And when you look at it from that way, then it'll be easy for you to make your listening, actual listening, and an act of worship and adoration, gratitude, service to God. Any thoughts on that?
Important to let ourselves be influenced by the word, because there's all kinds of influence in the world that we have to deal with every day that can, I guess, get us off track if we're not careful.
Mm-hmm. That's very true. Very true. It's the influence of the world, even in our worship, it cannot be underestimated. It can't be. The reason why it's important to make our listening an act of worship, to, as Hebrews says, to pay much closer attention to what we've heard, is because the Bible brings up that there are different kinds of listeners. Go to, you're in Hebrews, go to chapter 5. You know, let's read chapter 5, verse 11. Verse 11 and 12. Someone read verses 11 and 12 for me.
Concerning him, we have much to say, and it is hard to explain since you have become dull of hearing. For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you have need again for someone to teach you the elementary principles of the world of God. For you have come to need milk, not solid food.
About, I don't know, 6 or 7 years ago. And this was, remember how I mentioned about a few minutes ago about how me as a preacher, one of the things I needed to learn was patience in preaching? Well, one of the things that, before I learned that, I would get frustrated. And one of the things that frustrated me is that I remember where I used to preach, there was this guy, and, you know, you learn about who's in the congregation, so you find out that the man's been, you know, he's not a new Christian. He's been in the church for a long time. He's an older individual. But it One of the things that I noticed whenever I was up there preaching or in a Bible class and everything was that, and he wasn't the only one, I'm just using him as an example because I'm going to tell you what happened in a second, but yeah, I noticed people that, you know, in the sermon or Bible class, all right, please turn with me to whatever book, chapter, and verse, and there are some that they're just, they don't have the Bible open or they don't have it, they're on their phone, they're just, and they're not even looking at you, they're looking up, off, and when you see it happen over and over again, it's pretty obvious, you know, well, they're not listening. And this guy was one of them, and just week after week after week, just there in body but not in spirit, right? But I was told that he'd been a member of the church for decades. And so one night, Beth and I were over at his house for dinner. And we, you know, there's a social gathering and everything. And it was, you know, we were just talking and everything. And me being a preacher, you know, I got to bring up the Bible. And I just talk about the Bible a little bit. And just, I just had this thought. We were talking about the Bible. It was something basic, too. It was something, it wasn't like we were talking about Revelation or something. It was just something very basic. You know, basic thing of Christianity. And so just suddenly had the idea, I turned to the guy and I said, well, you know what I'm talking about. Where in the Bible is that? And what I was talking about was Acts 2:38. Repent and let every one of you be baptized for the forgiveness of your sins. Like, again, one of the basic things. Where that repent and be baptized, where is that? Do you remember where it is? And he was like, I don't know. And I was like, okay. And then I just moved on. But the reason I asked him was because I wanted to verify something. And what was verified, and he never knew it because I didn't make a big deal out of it. We just went on. But one of the things that was verified to me was like, here's a man that week after week after week, He doesn't open his Bible. I don't even think he brings a Bible. And it's clear that he never makes eye contact with me while I'm preaching or teaching. It's clear that he's just off in a while. And he's been a member of the church for decades. And one of the most foundational passages about baptism, about one of the most foundational things in the church, in Christianity, he's probably been in the same room where Acts 2:38 has been quoted and cited who knows how many Sundays, but he doesn't know it. He doesn't know it at all. And when I read this verse out of Hebrews now, the writer is going to talk to them about a pretty deep subject, Melchizedek. And he says it's hard to explain. But verse 11, he says the reason it's hard to explain is because you have become dull of hearing. And then he goes on to say, by this time, you ought to be teachers, but you need someone to teach you again the basic principles of the oracles of God. You need milk and not solid food. We have to make sure that we don't become dull of hearing. And one of the big things about human nature that makes this such a trap for us is, I mean, we've all, Sunday after Sunday, for decades, we've been coming to church, right? Well, the newness wears off, right? The newness wears off. It's human nature that when something is new, we are like, really on it. We're excited, we pay attention and things like that. But after a while, we begin to become complacent and we take it for granted. And that can very easily apply to our Christianity. That can very easily apply to the preaching of God's Word. And so what we have to do is we have to make sure that we don't become dull of hearing. One of the fruit of the Spirit is self-control, right? Well, self-control, it takes discipline to worship. it takes discipline to really focus on what you're doing. We talked about how it applies to singing and praying and the Lord's Supper. It applies to preaching as well. And you know what? It applies to me too. You know, we were talking, the elders and I were talking about playing that video of Don Blackwell. Well, I got that. It came in the mail, so we can do that. Well, you know, a friend of mine was paralyzed. You know, we're going to play on a Sunday morning. We're going to play on the screen his sermon. Now, I've listened to that sermon 4 times. I was there when he delivered it. So this could apply to me too. On the day that we do this, I'll be in the pews and I will have to make the conscious choice to listen. And it can be very easy if I'm not careful. Well, you know, I know what he's going to say. I've heard this before. You know, I've already listened. I own the DVD. I've already listened to this. So, okay. I'll do this or I'll do that. I'm not worshiping. And what I'm doing is I'm becoming dull of hearing. And when you allow that to happen, when you allow that habit to form, then it keeps you from growing as a Christian. It keeps you from growing as a Christian. This is what Jesus had to say about being dull of hearing. In Matthew 13, verse 13, he was explaining to his disciples why he taught in parables. Matthew 13, verse 13, he says, "This is why I speak to them in parables, because seeing they do not see, and hearing they do not hear, nor do they understand. Indeed, in their case, the prophecy of Isaiah is fulfilled that says, 'You will indeed hear, but never understand, and you will indeed see, but never perceive. For this people's heart has grown dull, and with their ears they can barely hear, and with their eyes they have closed, lest they should see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and turn, and I will heal them.'" Notice that last part. Turn, meaning repent. And what's the result? I would heal them. How does God heal us? This past week, this young couple in Middle Tennessee, a youth minister, a church in Cookeville, Tennessee, the tornado rips the roof right off of his, literally over his head, and him and his wife are holding on to their, very tightly to their 4-year-old daughter and their 1-year-old daughter, and in spite of holding on very tightly, they're ripped away from their daughters, and one of their daughters was found and has a head injury, still in the hospital. And the other one was found and passed away. Those are parents that need healing. How are they going to get it? Well, there's many ways. There are many ways. But I think one of the ways that over time they will receive healing is through hearing the word of God proclaimed to them. But they have to hear it. We all, if God is to heal us of our sin problem, if God is to heal us of the grief that we have, the anguish that we have, the suffering, we want God to heal us. Well, what Jesus is saying here is, these people, I would heal them. I would, but their heart has grown dull. They barely hear with their ears. They see, but they don't perceive. They are dull of hearing. People come to church a lot of times, and we walk up to them and we shake their hand. Hey, how are you doing? You get the standard culture. Oh, fine, fine. A lot of people are not fine. A lot of people there that come into this building on Sundays and Wednesdays, what's going on in their lives on Monday through Saturday, a lot of hurt. There's a lot of stress. There's a lot of worry. There's a lot of anxiety. And one of the things that I, as a preacher, one of the things that's on my mind, you know, what can I say that can provide healing to these people? You know? And I do my best to provide it as best I can. Sometimes I fall short because sometimes I don't know. And other times I fall short because I tried, but it wasn't the right thing that I said. I try to do better. But, you know, sometimes no matter what I would say, if it was the right thing that from God's word that needed to be said, if the people in the, if you in the pew are not an active listener, if you're dull of hearing, then it's not going to benefit you. It's not going to benefit you. I was going through a difficult time in my life back in 2005. Very, very difficult time in my life. And I wasn't preaching for about 9 months. So I was in the pews listening Sunday after Sunday. And I made the conscious decision with some of these verses in my mind. I made the conscious decision that I was going to not be dull of hearing. I don't care if the sermon was on something that I myself had preached, and maybe, you know, it's easy for me as a preacher to sit in the pew, someone else preaching, you know, I would have done that, or I would have used that verse, or I would have said that, you know, or I would not use that PowerPoint, I would have used different. Yeah, you know, I had to make the decision. I'm not going to do that. Instead, I'm going to focus on the message, even if I know what scripture he's about to say, even before he says it, I'm still going to turn to it, and I'm going to immerse myself in it. And guess what? I found that Sunday after Sunday, when I consciously made that effort with the singing and with the preaching and with the Lord's Supper and the praying, that every Sunday, without fail, no matter what the sermon was about, no matter if the song leader was the best song leader in the world or one of those guys that just was, you know, sang off tune, no matter what, I left that worship assembly pumped up spiritually, motivated spiritually. That was an awesome worship service. And guess what? It really had very little to do with the preacher and the song leader. And it had mostly to do with me deciding I wasn't going to be dull of hearing. I was going to immerse myself in what was being said. And it found that in the time of suffering that I was going through, the bitterness, the anger, the worry, the stress, the tears, and it was a lot of all of that during that 9 months in my heart. God was healing me. God was helping me get through it. God was providing medicine and repairing my broken heart. I have a lot to thank, a lot of gratitude for the preachers and the teachers that I listened to during that 9 month period. But if I hadn't made that decision to really listen, none of it would have helped me. So, you want God to heal you? You want God to help you? In the worship, when the sermon's happening, make listening an act of worship. Listen. Don't be dull. Don't be dull of hearing. Thoughts, questions? All right, well, that's really all I have on the on worship. I hope that these past few weeks that we've been going over worship and diving deep into it, I hope that it's been beneficial to you. I hope that we have a better understanding of how to worship and how to get more out of worship for ourselves. And again, now you guys came in just a little bit late, so I'll tell you what I told the rest of them. Starting next week, we are going to be going into Christian evidences. Evidence that is from outside the Bible, evidence in nature, evidence in archaeology, evidence in science that proves the validity and the truth of the Christian religion. Does God really exist? Well, where's the evidence for it? Is the Bible, Genesis through Revelation, really God's word, really from God? Where's the evidence for it? Did the flood of Noah really happen? Where's the evidence for it? We're going to be getting into a lot of deep stuff about that, and that'll take us through the spring. So be thinking about that. We're going to start that next week.
One thing I would say about, you know, people that lost their children, I think so many, even Christians think that God will make a perfect world, and then when something terrible like that happens, it's God's fault. And I think that's why it's important that, like you said, we look constantly in the Bible so we get the right message.
Exactly. Amen. Any other thoughts? All right, let's close with a word of prayer. Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your wisdom in having it proclaimed regularly through the preaching of it. I pray, Father, that you help me as a preacher and all other preachers of your gospel to preach the word and to do so with patience, to teach it, to help people understand it, to provide reproof and correction when it is needed, and to provide exhortation and encouragement and motivation to become closer to you at all times. I pray, Father, for everyone who listens. I pray for everyone here and all Christians who sit in the pews worldwide, that you can help them to have that open and honest heart, that they can listen and come to understand and to take what they hear and use it so that you can heal them and so that they can grow and salvation will be even more firmly in their grasp because of your grace and mercy. Father, thank you for giving us this time to study about worship these past few weeks, and we pray that our worship will be in spirit and in truth, that will be with reverence and adoration and gratitude for your power and your love and your compassion. And we pray, Father, that it will always be acceptable and pleasing to you and edifying for us. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.